We're back with episode 3 of the Saga of Sophie, and today we're going to do some reassembly. All right, we're back with Sophie again. I've got her parts cleaned, with the exception of a couple things I haven't touched yet. One being the bobbin case, the other being the bobbin case positioning bracket. I haven't touched the bobbin winder yet either, but all of her hardware is clean and polished. All of her other internals are ready to go. But the first thing I want to do is I want to put the needle bar bushing back in, because this is the biggest pain in the neck. Now, there's a hole, a threaded hole, in the back of the bottom of the needle bar bushing where a thread guide gets attached. So I'm going to position that in the appropriate locale and get that in what we would like to refer to as our starting position. I'm going to use an appropriate sized punch to kind of start to drive this down. I got that started. Now, I'm not going to get that all the way with this punch. This punch is not long enough. So, just like when we removed it, I'm going to find an appropriate larger size punch that will fit in the hole up top. Now I have another set that's in an index, but these are my utility ones. So I'm going to get that started here. And I'm just going to lightly tap this down. I'm not left-handed. I am profoundly right-handed. Yeah, I can't do that with my right hand. My left hand. Now, the nice thing is if I screw this up and I put it in too deep, I can just keep on going at this stage of the game and drive the bushing all the way out. Try again. See how we're doing. We're getting closer. That should be right it right there. Take a look at the bottom. Yep, that's right where I want it. So we're going to put the set screw back in. Actually, before I do that, let me confirm. Hey, the screw is right where I want it too. The threaded hole is going to be perfect. So we'll go ahead and we're going to get this set screw back in. I think we might be able to go down just another tap more. We are so close. I think that's going to put the set screw right into that groove where I wanted it. Yep. That feels great. Okay. Needle bar bushing is in. And let's just confirm that the needle bar is going to slide nicely in that, which it is. Okay, there's no lubrication in there whatsoever. And that feels really, really good. Okay, here's the battle plan. First of all, I've already put the retaining spring for the bobbin slide plate in. Forgive me for doing that off camera. But we've got all of the hardware polished. We've got all of the parts cleaned. The only things I haven't touched yet are the bobbin case positioning bracket, the bobbin case, and oddly enough, the stop motion washer. I haven't gotten around to doing that, nor the balanced wheel yet. Anyway, what we're going to start with, I'm going to clean this mess out of here, get us some space on the bench. I'm going to bring up my fixture, and we're going to start on the bottom of the machine. We're going to start by putting in her feed dog rock shaft. We're going to put in her hook assembly and all the driver stuff for the hook. We're not going to put in the, obviously, the bobbin case nor its positioning bracket, number one, because they're not clean, and number two, not going to put that in until we get the needle bar in and get the machine timed. So, yeah, we're going to hold it at that point. We're going to go ahead and do the bottom end first, so give me a couple of minutes, and we're going to talk about every bit of hardware as we put it back in place. All right, we've got Liz in the shop with us. She's on the other side of us here. She's working on an alto saxophone. So if you hear other strange noises in the background, it's just the lovely and talented Elizabeth bringing an old Bundy back to life for a friend. So Liz, tell us what you're doing on this thing. Well, what are we looking at, first of all?
This is an old Bundy saxophone that came in for a repad. So I'm...
An alto saxophone.
This is an alto saxophone. And I'm in the process of putting it back together again, which has gotten goofed up because I've had to take a couple of keys off it. So I'm... This portion here is what we call the stack section. So most of those keys are on, not everybody. And the pads are seated. And I've done some of the regulations and adjustments. And...
New pads?
Yeah, new pads and new corks. When you do a repad, everything gets washed, everything gets scrubbed, everything gets cleaned. And
that sounds like a sewing machine.
Pretty much sounds like a sewing machine.
We even use some of the same terminology.
Yep, we use pivot screws. We use
pivot screws, and we don't like lost motion. That's
yep,
true.
It's pretty much the same.
All right.
But so I'm in the process of reassembling. Reassembling this and doing some of the adjustments and getting it as ready as possible to get back to the customer, hopefully on Tuesday.
Nice. So. Anyway, we are going to start a little differently than I normally do. We're going to start with the bell crank assembly. Of course, this is the bell crank. This is the driving rod that connects the bell crank to the vertical shaft. Now, when this goes in, let's talk about orientations here. There's a flat and a curved surface to the driving rod. The curved surface faces towards the base of the machine. Now, in order to put this together, we have to attach the driving rod to the bell crank prior to putting the bell crank on. Now, the bell crank pivot bolt is already in place. So, I have the bolt, the appropriate screw here, machine screw, for the bell crank end. You can tell it's the appropriate one because it is the shoulder on that screw. This area here precisely fits the depth of the open end of the connecting rod. So we're going to go ahead, we're going to get that started on there, and we'll take a suitable screwdriver and we'll snug that up nicely. All right, now if I can find where I set, oh, here's where I set my oil bottle. We're going to, while we have access to this, it's going to get a little bit of oil right at the junction of those two parts. Move it around a little bit. Okay, the bell crank goes on thusly, and it goes on to the vertical shaft there. Now, the screw for the vertical shaft has a nice big fat head, a tiny, tiny amount of shoulder space. It's not even really shoulder. It's just where the screw thread is interrupted, and then very short screw thread. And it attaches down here thusly. Now, once again, going to snug it up well. And all right, we have the startings of a sewing machine. The next piece we're going to put on interfaces with the bell crank. It is the lifting arm with its bearing for the feed dog. So the screw for that, once again, it is shouldered, and you'll note that the length of the shoulder is identical to the height of the section where it's going through. It goes in, and that bearing actually is going to ride in the bearing on the bell crank. Now you'll note I haven't put the cap screw, or it's actually kind of a weird looking nut. I haven't put that onto the bell crank area yet. But that is in fact coming. And then we go ahead, we run the screw in and just snug it up a little bit. At this stage of the game, make sure that your set screw on the collar nut, is retracted out of the threaded area. You could put it on. And you'll make that finger tight. You'll want it snug, but just finger tight. All right? Actually, finger tight and then back it off just so that it feels like it's cracking loose, but just so that it's loose. And then go ahead and tighten the set screw. And this all should turn nicely, which it's not because I tightened that too much. There we go. And there we go. Now it's moving nicely. It's very easy to over-tighten that, as you just saw me do. Okay. Easy enough so far, right? Good. Next parts that are going to go on, we're going to start with the pivot screws for the feed dog rock shaft. Specifically, we're going to start at the pillar end. Notice that these have been completely cleaned and the pivot points on both of these have been polished. I did, if you'll recall, when we were cleaning this machine, I chased the threads on these holes just to make sure that these were clean. So I don't know if you recall when we were taking Sophie apart, this one did not want to come out. So, all right, we got that in. Now I'm going to take the feed dog rock shaft. Now you'll note I'm going to position this arm all the way forward. You'll note there's a bearing here. That's going to go into the fork on the lifting shaft. I have to back this one out just a touch. I ran it in a little too far. Get it in position. There we go. There we go. I tell you, this is, if you haven't built one of these fixtures or if you've been on the fence about it, this is the kind of stuff where having a fixture like this makes all the difference in the world. It makes it so much easier to reassemble the bottom of these machines. Not to mention it protects it nicely while you're doing it. Okay, and there we go. Now, I'm going to temporarily just loosen this here a little bit so I can get this adjusted correctly. I don't want any lateral motion on this rod. That's what we call lost motion. So I get it so that it's just snug, and then I back it out maybe an eighth to a sixteenth of a turn. And then I'm going to bring this nut down just to snug it up a little bit. I'm not going to tighten it. I'm just going to snug it while I'm holding the pivot screw with a screwdriver. And I still have good motion, free motion in this direction, and maybe 10 thou of lateral motion. That'll be fine. So what we're going to do next, which is very different than a way a lot of people will show you how to do this. Next operation I'm going to perform is I'm going to take her off of the fixture, and I'm going to put her her feed fork in and her stitch length regulator. And after we get that done, then we're going to put the feed dogs on and adjust the whole feed mechanism while we've got her in that position. I don't know how many of you have watched the recent video by Jen DeLeo on putting the featherweights feed regulator back together again. If you haven't seen it, you really should. It is excellent. But this is a completely different process for a 66 than it is for a 221. So, but some of the parts are similar. We have the bearing. We have the fork. The fork has a stud on it that the bearing sits on. So I'm going to just set that on there for the moment. Set that out aside. Next part we have to concern ourselves with is the feed regulator pivoting slider. You'll notice it has a threaded hole in it, and the bolt which mounts it, and its lock washer. Notice that the lock washer has these three tabs. You want those tabs pointing away from the head of the screw, thusly, and so it'll be going towards the machine. So we're going to set this off to the side at the moment, just set that down, and we're going to set this down at the moment. We also have the now freshly cleaned and polished screw regulator. So I'm going to put the screw regulator in just a few turns here just to get her started. Now, I'm going to take the fork, and you guys have seen this happen before, I am sure. I'm going to put the adjust the vertical shaft so that it is in the downward, so that the arm on it is down towards the needle end. Makes it easier to get the fork in. Then bring the fork in and put it up onto the cam, and then rest the fork, the small end of the fork, on the feed dog rock shaft. Now, as you recall, the feed dog rock shaft has this eccentric screw. Okay? I've been keeping the nut on it. I'm going to set the nut in my other parts tray for the moment. And I'm just temporarily going to put the eccentric screw and hold that in place so I don't have to balance around that. Now here comes the fun part. I was in this edit room working on the final version of the video when I realized that I did not capture footage that I thought I captured. Anyway, so the machine is back together, but I came back into the shop. I took the stitch link regulator out because I want it to be abundantly clear how to get this part in and the orientation of how it fits. Now, I just removed the stitch length regulator itself. I showed putting the fork with the bearing on into the machine. Well, we'll consider that as being pretty fundamental to the process. Likewise, the small end of the fork is resting upon the feed dog rock shaft, so that doesn't have to be undone at this point. Now, the screw type stitch length regulator, you'll want to move the screw in so that it's about that far into the machine, which is, as you're looking down, you're just starting to see the entirety of the end of the screw that engages with the small protruding tab right here on the regulator itself. All right, now the bearing you can see is on the post and it's down in the hole. So what I'm going to do, normally I do this with magnets and I do it real fast and you really can't see a whole heck of a lot. But I'm going to do it a little differently. I'm only going to block your view very, very shortly. This little tab, this little protuberance on the stitch length regulator, it's going to go in and it's going to be on the at what would wind up being the bottom end of the screw portion. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get it in the hole. I'm going to get the little tab engaged there. And then I'm going to use my thumb, possibly another finger, to get in here and pivot this so that this section of the stitch length regulator catches the bearing and slides up over the bearing. All right, let's see if I can do this. No magnets this time, which is definitely not the way I normally do this. Okay, I've got it on. It's on the screw, and voila. It looks like I got it in pretty close, and we'll just get in here. I'm going to take a screwdriver and just push it around a little bit. There we go. I've got it lined up. Now, it doesn't look lined up very well, so I'm just going to... Okay. Trying to get my fat head out of the way here. Now, when the attachment bolt goes on with its lock washer, note that there's three little tabs on the lock washer that are bent. You want those tabs to be bent away from the head of the screw, so they're going towards the body of the machine. Get that in. Get yourself a good size screwdriver. Start screwing it down. Now, as far as how tight do you make this? If you crank it on real tight, this mechanism is going to be more difficult to move. So here's where you get to, like here, I've got that on wicked tight, that's harder to move. So I'm going to back it off just a little bit, and that feels real, real nice. Now, keep in mind, when you make the rest of the adjustments, you're going to want the stitch length regulator screwed all the way in, so you might as well go ahead and put it there at this point, because we're going to go ahead and we're going to be making some other adjustments to the mechanism. Okay, Sophie is back in the fixture, so I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to put her feed dog back in with her screw. Once again, this would be a lot easier if I could be in the position where you're at. I could see what I'm doing. Right now, I really can't see anything. Okay, I'm going to just snug her feed dog in. Not going to make it super tight. All right, we're going to bring her back to the upright position for the next part of this. Next part of the process, we're going to temporarily put the needle plate back on. Pardon my paw there. Don't have to put this on tight. Just get the screws so they bottom out and the needle plate fits onto the machine properly. Now, one word of caution, make sure you clean the bottom and the edges of the needle plate that you're going to be using, because if you don't, it might not sit where it's going to sit when it is clean. So you want to do this with cleaned parts. Okay, let me readjust the camera shot here so you can see a little bit better. You'll note right now that the feed dog is binding up with this side of the needle plate. So I'm going to loosen ever so slightly the feed dog rock shaft, so I can laterally move the feed dogs towards the pillar end of the machine, just a skosh. I'm doing that, and then just with my finger, I'm just tightening up the nut a little bit. I'm going to come back on this side, and I'm going to loosen the screw, just so I can loosen the nut a little bit. And then I'm once again going to run this in to take out the lost motion. Very good. And now I don't have problematic lost motion. What I do have is I can't see through the camera, but I did go a little far. So I'm going to loosen that just a skosh, come back around this side of the tripod, and run that in a little bit more. And I think I might have hit it here on the nose. Yeah, that looks good. Now, with the stitch length regulator all the way in, all right, the feed dog height is a little high. I'm not worried about that at the moment. But what I am worried about is the adjusting screw, the eccentric screw for the feed dog. Now notice, I'm going to put this back, turning the hand wheel. That's the beginning of the stroke. That's the back end. I'm going to turn just the eccentric screw. I'm going to back it off just a little bit to give a little bit more clearance on the back end. And then I'm going to put that adjusting nut, that locking nut on lightly, just finger tight. And then turn the hand wheel once again. And that's pretty much at full travel. That's pretty much centering the travel of the feed dog in the needle plate. So we're good. Let me get her back into the cradle. We know our eccentric screw is in good adjustment. So holding the head with a screwdriver firmly, just double checking, and I'm going to tighten that nut. Still feels good. We know these pivot screws are adjusted correctly, so once again, holding the pivot screw, actually usually use a different screwdriver than that, so we have a little bit more oomph on the blade. There we go. I'm going to use my 9/16 wrench to tighten that side. I'm going to walk around the camera. Use my 9/16 wrench to tighten this side once again while I'm holding the screw with my big beefy screwdriver. How's that feel? Feels and looks good, but you know what? I suspect that shifted just a touch. It felt like it did. So, here. All right. There, it's on. There we go. Perfect. And now we'll go ahead, just put a drop of oil both of those pivot points. We'll put a little tiny drop of oil on the two bearings here that make up that portion of the mechanism. And bada bing, bada boom, that's good. What we will do now, though, is we're going to take off the needle plate and the feed dog. They don't need to be on for this portion. Next to go on is going to be the hook. The hook, as you know, it's very important to clean the inside. I clean and polish it because the bobbin case is going to ride on this edge, so you want this super, super clean. All right, so the hook is going to come up from the other side, and the hook actuating arm will go on thusly. Don't worry about the position of the hook and the arm just yet. We'll worry about that when we actually time it. And it should move quite smoothly. The dog bone, the last part of the linkage here that goes to the bell crank, you'll notice its actuating, its mounting bolt is also shouldered like other bolts we have seen. And once again, the shoulder on that bolt is matched very carefully to the thickness of the dog bone. So, we'll put the dog bone onto the machine. And let me find a more suitable screwdriver. Once again, you don't have to crank it on. Just get her firm. Just nice and snug. There's oiling points here. There's a hole on either end of the dog bone. And there's an oiling port on the casting for the hook. So now, that's moving nicely. Okay. Nothing else for us to do on the bottom of the machine at this time. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to pull everything off of the bench once again and bring out the vinyl covered board, because we're going to do the rest of this reassembly off of the fixture. To put this thread guide back on, I find it far easier to have the machine sitting on her nose supported on a block of wood. And then you can get in there with the guide and the screw, and at least gravity is your friend here. And this being the smallest screw in the machine, or on the machine, there you go. It's the easiest way of getting that back on. We'll continue our needle bar box with the lifter lever for the presser foot. Now, that too has a shouldered machine screw. And you'll note that the shouldered machine screw is, focus, there we go. The shoulder on the machine screw is slightly larger than the thickness of the presser bar. And I like using my grippy tool to hold the screw to get her started. Now, that shoulder has to be a little bit longer because this is going to just flop, and it needs to be able to just flop. The transfer fork for the upper thread tension assembly has this recessed area on it that the shouldered screw for the fork rides in. The end result is that the length of the shoulder is just ever so proud behind the back of the transfer fork when it's installed, because I want to be able to do this so you guys can see what's going on. I'm going to use a new screw starter that viewer Harlan sent me, and that is nice. Get that in there, starter right up. Oh, Harlan, you were right, sir. That is awesome. Thank you so much. And we'll just get that started in. And that is, the spring action is good. That's going to work just fine. Okay. It's time to start putting the needle bar in. Next up, I'm going to put a little bit of sewing machine oil on this needle bar and just wipe it down to get any last buffing dirt off of the needle bar itself and stick it in the hole, and she drops right in. We're going to leave her in that position at the moment. Next item we're going to put in is going to be the thread take-up arm. That is secured with another shouldered bolt, and once again, the shouldered bolt sticks is pretty much slightly proud, not quite even, but slightly proud of the back. And we'll get it in position. We've got a proper fitting screwdriver blade. That's a Chapman. What's the number on that? It's a 19. Is that a 19 or 61? Looks like a 19. Sometimes these Chapmans, I can't tell. I have to flip them over to see which side I'm looking at. All right, so that's in. That fits good. Now, on the offset crank pin, you'll notice that there's a flat on it. There is a set screw inside on the cam located here that is going to be engaging. So I'm going to make sure that screw is backed out a little bit. If I can see what I'm doing, and I can't. There we go. All right. So now I'm going to make sure the flat is aimed towards that set screw. And now I have to back that set screw out for real. I don't think I was actually hitting it before. I had run that in a considerable amount when I was polishing around inside and cleaning inside of here. There we go. That found it. Okay. Now we want the flat aimed towards the set screw. And there it is. Now, get the screwdriver going again. And you can see, watch the offset arm as I tighten this. I deliberately kind of push it to the side a little bit. There, you see it move when I tighten up the screw. These 66s don't have legs on the bottom, so in order to move them, you kind of have to tilt things sometimes. All right, we are almost to the point of being able to put a needle in it and time it. This machine didn't come from the factory with timing gauge and timing marks, so I pulled one out of my collection of parts, and so we're going to put that in. Because she looks this good, she might as well be easy to adjust. We'll go ahead and get that in and bring that down. And not worrying about needle bar height at the moment, just worried about getting the needle bar onto the machine. And there, it's on. And now the last portion of that is the opposite-handed screw that goes into the, secures the connecting rod. And of course, by opposite-handed, I mean that tightens by turning to the left instead of to the right. And there we go. Before we go too much further in assembling the needle bar box area, I want to go ahead and put the needle clamp back on. And I'm going to put a needle on this machine, and we're going to adjust the timing. Why not? We might as well. All right, we have the needle bar linkages at a full vertical position here. Everything is straight up and down. So now we have adjusted the timing gauge so that the top of the mark is even with that upper mark that's on the needle clamp. So if we turn the balance wheel, in this case the main shaft, so that the mark is even, the top of the gauge is even with the lower mark, this is when we will adjust the timing so that the point of the hook is directly behind the needle. The screw we're going to be loosening is right here. And I'm going to move the hook, making sure that that adjustment is right where we left it there. It's back where it belongs. Now I'm going to move the hook ever so slightly so that it's directly behind the point of the needle. I'll show you a close-up of that in a moment. And then I'm going to snug that screw back up. Okay, we have the needle bar linkages in their fully extended, full down position, which puts our timing mark at the upper mark on the needle bar clamp. Now, moving the needle bar upwards by turning the main shaft in the direction of normal rotation until that top of the timing mark matches the lower mark on the needle bar clamp, that brings us into perfect timing, as you can see here. I'm going to go ahead and take this needle off of the machine, as I really don't feel like stabbing myself while I'm working on it, but I will leave the clamp in place. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to put, once again, temporarily, and people are going to probably beat me up for this, but I put the needle plate on and off. I do that on and off several times throughout the process. It's the way I do it. You don't have to do it this way. It's the way I do it. If you don't like it, I'm sorry. Yes, the feed dogs are not in yet. Feed dog is not in because I'm going to hold off putting the feed dog in until we have the bobbin case positioning bracket and the bobbin case in. And the last adjustment we'll be making will be the feed dog height. The feed dog lateral and fore and aft positions are already established and they're just fine. Okay, let's go ahead and put the rest of this together. So, I'm going to make sure on the sliding block that the set screw is retracted a little, and I'm going to hold that off to the side, and the sliding block is now in place, and oh, does that feel good. I'm glad we polished the snot out of that. Okay, this is our replacement presser foot, or I should say a presser bar. And I'm going to go ahead and put the presser foot clamp on because we're going to kill two birds with one stone here. As we're putting this together, we'll make the adjustment as well. So we'll go ahead and put a presser foot on. You can see that that is retracted well inside. Not quite as tall as a stock one is, but it's close enough. All right. We have... actually, we can go ahead and adjust this right now. I'm going to get that so it's just coming up off the block, just coming up off the stop by maybe a 64th of an inch. I want just a little bit of slop there, just like that. Okay, so that's about a 64th of an inch travel. But what we're going to do. Now we're going to loosen it just enough so we can turn this, and we're going to center the hole in the needle plate inside the split of the foot, and then go ahead and tighten the screw. We have just a little bit of give, and it comes up and it's fine. Now if we use the gauge from the featherweight shop, you'll see we're actually right about where they're at, which whatever this number is, but it's close enough for government work. Okay, I'm going to drop the spring in, which didn't, if you remember, didn't want to come out that way very easily. Raising this to bring that to the top makes it easier to get that washer on. And now we will put the adjuster screw. We can go ahead and run the adjuster down. And oh, isn't that a lot better looking than it was before? Drop a little oil down there. Just a little bit of oil here. Let it work in. Just a little bit on the side. Okay. Last but not least for this portion is the slack thread regulator, which just goes on with one little screw. This is another one I normally do with the machine sitting at her with her butt up in the air. But here we go. Slack thread regulator on there. Change screwdriver bits. Where's the screwdriver bit I wanted? This is the screwdriver bit I wanted. And there we go. Slack thread regulator is on. Bada bing, bada boom. Now this is not going to move nicely because, once again, this doesn't have feet and there's mechanism banging up against the table here. Oh, you know, I never took that screw off to clean it. I will get there. Anyway, we're going to take this presser foot back off, and we're going to call it an episode, and, nah, actually we won't. Hold on. Got the upper cap. Put that in place and press it in, and grab our little plastic face hammer. Knock that down so it's just doming up. Now we're going to call it an episode. Well, there you have it. Next episode, we're going to come back. We're going to work on the upper thread tension assembly. We're going to work on the bobbin case positioning bracket. And we might even get to the bobbin winder. Not 100% about that. But anyway, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next episode.